नमस्ते ऑल, आई एम ग्लैड टू इंट्रोड्यूस यू टुडे ए ग्रेट पर्सनालिटी, इंडीड ए हिस्टोरियन ऑफ नेशनल रेप्यूट, प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर केशवन वेलुथट. आई हैव इनवाइटेड हिम टुडे हियर टू स्पीक अबाउट हिज बेस्ट फ्रेंड डॉक्टर बी सुरेंद्र राव, हु हैपन्स टू बी माय कजिन ब्रदर. It's exactly after 1 year of his death that we are here on this platform. Dr. Keshavan Valathat had an association with my brother for about 3 decades. He knows the veins, arteries, and nerves of Dr. Surendra Rao better than me. I remember Dr. Surendra Rao mentioning Professor Keshavan Valathat as he was and he is my alter ego, who more than anyone had loved me as a friend, shaped my understanding of history, read everything I wrote, and had made my work in the university enjoyable and rewarding. He was my best intellectual prop and my best critic. Surendranath said about Dr. Keshavan, I have not come across with this kind of sentiments expressed in an intellectual society anywhere else. Their friendship was unique, and my brother used to always tell me a lot more about Dr. Keshavan during our conversation at home. Surendra Rao used to tell me that Dr. Keshavan's English was much more superior to him. On behalf of Ranjani Memorial Trust Facebook page, I extend you, sir, a very warm welcome to remember Dr. B. Surendra Rao. We are eagerly waiting to listen to you, to know about my brother, whom we adored as an abode of knowledge, simplicity, and non-advertising. Dr. Keshavan Valathat hails from Thrissur, Kerala. He had his post-graduation MA in history from Calicut University in 1974. He is MPhil from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi in 1978. PhD from University of Calicut in 1987. He joined Mangalore University as a lecturer in history in 1982, along with Dr. B. Surendra Rao, who joined there as a reader. He took voluntary retirement from Mangalore University in 2008, when Dr. Rao also got retired upon superannuation. Perhaps Dr. Keshavan sir thought that it is not wise to be in the department without Rao. Later, he opted to join the University of Delhi in 2009. He was visiting professor of history, visiting Paris, New Delhi, and Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, Kerala. He knows Malayalam, Tamil, Kannada, Sanskrit, other than his lovable language, English. He has produced many PhDs, 16 books, over 50 articles, all internationally recognized. He had associated himself with the NAC in assessing universities and colleges in our country. He is a life member of Indian History Congress. Once again, I welcome you, sir, for today's Surendra Rao's Remembrance Day. My brother Surendra Rao is not known to the general public, though he had given many public speeches in our districts. He is known only in the intellectual quarters and in the field of history. I am sad that I have not retained any audio or video clippings of his speech or any of his close association clippings in my family. He was very close to all, but led a very lonely life with his book world. He had no time to enter into the public life to share his knowledge unless demanded. Perhaps your talk on him would reflect more about his attitude towards academics and his interests in the public life and family life. Will you please enlighten us, sir, with the musings of your association with him? Sir, over to you, please.
Thank you, Arvinda, for the nice words that you have to say about me. I don't think many of the things that you said are really true. But then, being friends, you have the freedom to exaggerate about me. That is what the friends should do about other friends. I know this. My association with Professor Surendra Rao, as you said, is strictly professional. In fact, I had very vaguely heard about him before I came across him in Mangalore in 1982. Now, I had done a refresher course in Mysore in 1980, where teachers from different colleges affiliated to Mysore University. At that time, there was no Mangalore University. Teachers from many colleges affiliated to Mysore University were part of this refresher course. Most of them students of Professor Sheikali. And they used to say, we miss Surendra Rao here. Then when this name was repeated over and over again, I asked them, who on earth is this Surendra Rao? Then they said that perhaps he was the best student that this department produced in recent years. He is a teacher in one of the colleges in Puttur. I hadn't heard the name of that place, Puttur. So I learned that there was a place called Puttur, that there was a Vivekananda College, that there was a teacher of history there called Surendra Rao, whom all of his classmates, seniors and juniors and teachers held in high esteem. So I thought that he should be a good scholar. He should be a great teacher. This happened in 1980. Then the following year, towards the end of 1981, December 1981, we were interviewed for the teaching position in Mangalore University. Those days, Mangalore University office was in the city of Mangalore on the Lighthouse Hill in the hostel building of St. Aloysius College. So there, Professor Sheikali himself, who was a teacher of Surendra Rao, was the vice chancellor. And one of the experts was delayed, his flight was delayed, and we had to wait indefinitely. We were all there at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and up to 7 o'clock, the experts did not turn up. So for about 4 hours, we didn't have anything to do. And I happened to meet this gentleman, very, very handsome, very, very interesting conversation. And he was also very funny in the way in which he was talking. I was very impressed, but I did not go very, very freely because I wasn't very sure that we are going to be colleagues there. I had applied for a reader's position. He had applied for a reader's position. And he was a PhD. I was not a PhD yet. So I never had a chance to go anywhere near that university at that time. Then in the interview, at the end of the interview, the chairman of the board, that is Professor Sheikali, asked me, well, Mr. Kesavan, if we are not able to offer you a reader's position, will you accept a lecturer's position? Then I said, yes, provided that you protect what I am drawing in Kerala now. I had already 6 years service, and my salary was not at the beginning of the lecturer's scale. I am getting so much. If you are ready to protect that, I will accept it. Otherwise, I may not be. Then he said, okay, thank you, and we left. Even there, I wasn't sure that they will offer me this position. Now, here is a person who had applied for reader's position, and that person being appointed as a lecturer, I didn't consider it as a very, very... this was sometime in the middle of December. End of December that year, the Indian History Congress was meeting in Bodh Gaya. One of the experts in the interview board, Professor R.S. Sharma, he was there in Bodh Gaya, and he called me and he told me that the board has decided to put you as number one on the lecturers panel and number two on the readers panel. So you are number two on the readers panel. Then he's a very funny person. He said, I understand that fellow is somewhere in a place called Puttur. Go and do something about him so that you can join as reader. The typical Bihari style. The typical Bihari style, he was telling me. So I knew that he is selected as reader and I was selected as lecturer. We will be together. There was no reason for me to be excited about being his colleague because he was practically a stranger, except that I had heard about him from his classmates and teachers. Then I came back, and naturally, since I was curious about what kind of a person I am going to work with, I made some inquiries, and the reports I had were not wonderful reports. The reports I had was, no, he is a very good scholar, all right. He is a very brilliant teacher, but it's better that you keep him at arm's length. This is the advice that I had got. The reason is, they knew my temperament. They knew my political affiliation. They knew my philosophical preoccupation. And that person also knew his temperament and his political affiliation or lack of it. Now, he had no political affiliation. So, since they knew this, they said that it's better that you don't rub shoulders very closely. Keep him at arm's length so that you can be good colleagues. So it was with this reservation that I joined Mangalore University. I reported on the 8th of February and he reported on the 10th. So I used to teasingly tell him that I'm senior to you. I'm senior to you by 2 days. I joined 2 days earlier. Then gradually we came to know each other. He used to come every day from Puttur, about 60 kilometers away. And those days, transport was not as frequent as it is today. So he used to take a train in the morning, reach the university, get down at Ekurgudda, and from there take a bus and come to the university. I too was staying near Thalapadi with a relative of mine. So we would be together. Lunch we used to eat in the men's hostel. In the men's hostel, there was this provision that lunch will be provided for people from outside. There used to be a person from Payyanur, a certain Nambishan, who was a cook. He used to cook very well, and we used to eat there. So, going together for lunch, sharing the same room, etc., we started talking, but still, I had this reservation. I was very cautiously approaching him. No, because I didn't want to rub him on the wrong side and make an enemy so that my future life will be miserable. I didn't want to do that. So I was very careful. I was very reserved. And then one day we were teaching a syllabus which Mysore University was teaching. The MA syllabus of Mangalore University, when the university began, it was the syllabus of Mysore University. So between us, we said that there are two problems about the syllabus. For one thing, it is antediluvian, very, very old kind of understanding of history, no new knowledge is available there. It's absolutely outdated kind of knowledge that you are teaching there. But I understand that this is a syllabus which our Vice Chancellor has prepared. So it is very, very sensitive to tell him, we don't want the syllabus, we have to change it. But we can tell him one thing. Anyway, this is a good syllabus. Mysore University is teaching it anyway. So why should two universities teach the same syllabus? Why should Mangalore duplicate Mysore? Mysore is doing good work. Let Mysore continue to do the good work. We will do this. We will convince Professor Sheikhali. So, Surendra Rao and I, when he was returning home, he used to take a bus from Mangalore. So we went there, and the bus stand was not very far away from the university office. We went to the university office in St. Aloysius College compound, met Professor Sheikhali and told him, incidentally, sir, you know, we were thinking why we really have to duplicate what Mysore is doing. This good work anyway Mysore is doing. So why shouldn't we introduce some changes here and there in the syllabus? He was very enthusiastic. He said, yes, do it by all means. It is absolutely important that new things are introduced. Honestly, this is a syllabus which I had prepared. And I was myself conscious that this is a very outdated syllabus. So you update the syllabus, you make it up to date. So he gave us a blank check, so to say. Now, when I am talking about Surendra Rao, it will be incomplete if I did not mention the great teacher that he had, Professor Sheikhali. Professor Sheikhali gave us this blank check, and then we would discuss it in restaurants, everywhere except the university department, because university departments are not places where academics can be discussed. So we would discuss the syllabus, we would discuss whatever we should have it. So we thoroughly recast the syllabus. It is not just the syllabi of each paper, the entire structure of the course. The MA course that Mangalore University was teaching became entirely different from the MA course that was available anywhere in India. Now, I was familiar with what was happening in different universities in India. I could get copies of it, and we made it entirely different. And there I realized that the fears that I had about Surendra Rao, that here is a person whom you have to deal with carefully. Here is a person whom you have to keep at arm's length. That is a totally unfounded fear. Everything. So I would suggest, no, we should have a whole paper on the history of Western civilization. History of Europe was what was being taught. I said, why Europe? We will have civilizational history, history of Western civilization. And he said, let's start from Greek civilization. Then I said, no, that would be too unwieldy. So let us have it only in relation to the modern period. Let us have it from, say, 17th century onwards. Scientific revolution, French revolution. Like that, let us start there. He liked the idea. Similarly, I said, we will not have this nonsense of Indian history from Indus Valley to Indira Gandhi. Indira Gandhi was the prime minister at that time. So I said that this idea of India from Indus Valley to Indira Gandhi, that kind of a history is absolutely useless. Then we designed separate courses of Indian history. We designed two full papers on the philosophy of history. What is history? Why do we study this? A full paper, a full MA paper on the philosophy of history. Another paper on the methods of studying history, how to study history. Like this, we recast the entire program of study. It was about 3-4 months hard labor. And Professor Sheikhali, every time we used to prepare this, we would take it to him. He used to compliment us. He used to encourage us. I had the fear that he would be unhappy. No, rather than being unhappy, he was going out of his way to encourage us and compliment us for this. Then Professor Sheikhali had perhaps some of the best minds in South India on the Board of Studies. Professor V.M. Reddy from Tirupati, Professor MGS Narayanan, my own teacher from Calicut, Professor Rangaswamaya from Mysore. So one of the best boards of studies that you can imagine in South India he gave us, and we just had to present this, and that board accepted us. But the result was not just that we had a good syllabus. The result was that here were two friends who became inseparable. So Surendra Rao and I, from that day onwards, when we had completed that, we became practically inseparable. And this was in the year 1982, February we joined. By 82 June, we were able to have the syllabi passed through the various bodies. And in July, when the university reopened, we were able to introduce the new syllabi. So it was only the first batch which studied the old syllabus of Mysore University. From the second batch onwards, we were able to teach our own. Then we went on updating the syllabus. It's not as if once in 10 years, once in 20 years, the university will revise the syllabus. No. We were revising the syllabus of History MA at least once in 3 years, once in 4 years. No syllabus there when we retired. No syllabus there was more than 3 years old. No syllabus was. This was because of the readiness that Surendra Rao had. Now, I had the good fortune, before I joined Bangalore University, I had the good fortune to be associated with some of the best centers of historical study. Now, I was myself trained in Calicut, which was one of the best centers of history. Then, I had the good fortune of being trained in JNU, where the last words of history in India, like Professor Bipin Chandra, Romila Thapar, S. Gopal, they were my teachers. And Surendra Rao used to tell me, Keshava, I am envious of you. I am envious of you. You had such great teachers like Sri Kumaran Nair, like MGS Narayanan, like Romila Thapar, like Bipin Chandra, like Sri Kali, etc. Then I used to tell him, but I have greater reason to be envious of you, because I am what little I am because of my teachers, because I had great teachers. But what about you? You are what you are because of you. And there is a lot of difference. When you are a self-made man, you are certainly greater than somebody whom others made. Great. So if I'm not very, very, what do I say, falsely modest to say that I am bad. I am not. I am good in my field. In the field of history in India, I have some standing, but then I owe it to a large number of people. In the case of Surendra Rao, he did not owe it to anybody, exclusively to himself. Uncompromising reading, a readiness to accept what came his way. Now, rather than saying, hey, these are all newfangled ideas, I'm not interested, he will not say that. Huh. Now, when I tell him, for example, now there is this book on Shudras by R.S. Sharma. Why don't you read it? He would immediately buy it and read it. And I don't have to tell you about the passion that he had for buying books. He would immediately buy the book and read it. And Keshavan, this is very different from the way in which we are taught history. And then I said, yes, this is the way in which people are doing history. So history of the lower orders in society is something that you can study. This is something that then in 1982, not long after we joined, we took our students on study tour to different parts of South India. And when we went on study tour in a bookshop in Bangalore, in a bookshop in Bangalore, I pointed to certain books. I remember even now, one was Death of the Past by J.S. Plum. The other was Lynn White's Medieval Technology and Social Change. I told him, these are some of the ways in which people are taking a different look at history now. Then that was the time when the series of subaltern studies was coming out from Oxford University Press. He saw them, he picked them up. And then after a few weeks, he told me, Keshavan, the kind of history that I had studied, now I realize it's not history at all. And I said, yes, it is history. It is on the foundations that you have studied in Mysore, because you had such a solid foundation where scholars like Sheikh Ali and Rangasamaya had prepared the solid foundation. Since you have the solid foundation, you are able to build upon that. The misfortune is that many of them forget about building about it. So it becomes a foundation without any superstructure on it, absolutely useless. He was able to build on it. So, you know, what I'm saying is the readiness that he had to accept new ideas. And there, it was not an uncritical acceptance. For instance, this subaltern studies that I was talking about. Now, there are very, very brilliant, interesting insights. But then the basic assumption, I remember, he was ready. He was able to question the basic assumptions there. Do you mean to say that there is no India at all? So that is what he used to ask. Now, when you read the subaltern studies, you get the impression that you have this region, that region, you have this section of society, that's the section of society. But where is India? Do you mean to say that there is no India at all? So this kind of an assumption, he was not ready to accept. A second thing about Surendra Rao is that he never believed in protocols, hierarchy, protocol, etc. is something which he never believed in. I remember when we joined for a few months, there was a professor, Professor Kuru, who was the head of the department. But Professor Kuru left and Surendra Rao was the head of the department for a long time. And I was a junior teacher there. But the way in which we were moving, many people did not like. Many of our colleagues in other departments did not like the way in which we were moving. Now, how can a head of the department and a junior teacher in the same department behave like this? So one of them, now I don't want to name the person, one of them very, very privately advised Surendra Rao. Surendra, you have to be careful about dealing with your colleagues. He did use the word colleagues. You have to be careful about dealing with your juniors. Now, if you behave the way in which you are behaving with Keshavan, he will not have any respect for you. He will not have any respect for you. I understand that you go to restaurants together. You go to the canteen together. He smokes in front of, I used to smoke those days very heavily. He smokes in front of you. You shouldn't allow that. No, he should respect you because he is junior to you. Then Surendra Rao told him, respect is not something to be demanded. Respect is to be commanded. And I don't think I command a respect from him. If at all, I respect him. So this kind of an attitude that your position, the scale of pay on which you draw your salary and your position, these are one thing and your real worth doesn't depend on that. He was very, very conscious, very clear about that. I don't think in Mangalore University those days, there was any other department where the first thing a teacher would do to a student when he enters your room, please sit down. No student was allowed to sit in front of a teacher in the department, in any other department except history department. In history department, Surendra Rao did not find any problem if I stood and sat down in front of you. Now, in fact, the furniture in the department, the three or four chairs in front of the chairman's table were meant for visitors. And if a student is a visitor, that is meant for him or her. The students in the beginning had problem sitting there. Then we insisted that you should sit there. Then when research scholars joined the department, he said that we are not going to have attendance register for the research scholars. So one of them asked, "But sir, how do you know if we are present?" Then he said, "If you sign the attendance register, we know that you are doing your research from 10 to 5. I want you to do research 24 hours a day, not 8 hours a day. So why should you reduce yourself into a part-time research scholar when you are a full-time research scholar?" So he didn't maintain, he didn't allow an attendance register for full-time research scholars to be maintained in the department. There was absolutely no hierarchy. He took the same number of hours of class, in fact, more than other teachers in the department. Now, usually there is this quote-unquote workload for teachers. A professor so many hours, readers so many hours, lecturers so many hours. No, in that department, there was no such distinction. Every teacher was teaching the same number of hours. He enjoyed teaching. And I remember somebody asked him, "Professor Rao, what is your specialization?" He said, "My specialization is teaching." ancient medieval model. He said, I am interested in ancient, medieval and modern. And my specialization is teaching, I teach. And he used to teach uncompromisingly. Uncompromising is the word. Now, our timetable was that every period was 2 hours duration. Oh. Not 1 hour duration. In the department, every period was 2 hours duration. And at the end of the second hour, the other teacher will have to wait at the door before he opened the door because he would always overstay in the class. He would go beyond 2 hours. He would go on endlessly. And I don't have to tell you, you know, it was very, very, very difficult to stop him when he starts talking. And particularly, and such impeccable kind of lectures from the point of view of the erudition of the subject that he was teaching, from the point of view of the way in which he presented it, and what an English. Now, you were saying, talking about me, that he thought that my English was great. I don't mean to say that my English is bad. As I told you, I'm not falsely modest. My English is not bad, but in terms of the command over vocabulary, the vocabulary that he had, I couldn't hold a candle to him. That is the reality. I couldn't hold a candle to him. Now, perhaps in matters of usage, structure, syntax, grammar, etc., because I had studied English the hard way. Because my father taught me English grammar, and I don't have to tell you, when your father teaches you grammar, it's not just English grammar that you learn, it is also the ways of torture that you learn. So it was a torture for me to learn English, but since I was taught English through torture, through what the police say, third degree methods, since I learned English through third degree methods, my grammar was very, very sound. And Surendra Rao never bothered to study English through grammar, that formal thing. So he used to show, and I would say that here there is this error of proximity, there is a mistaken sequence of tense, etc. And he said, You know, he used to say that. And then he had a level and I mean correct model. He used to say this. But going beyond that, the command that he had over the vocabulary in English language, you know, I haven't seen a person who had such a rich command over the vocabulary of the English language. So now what I'm saying about is teaching. One is the erudition in the subject that he was teaching. Second is the style of presentation. Third is the language, that is the communication, the means of communication that he was employing for teaching what he had. So the most up-to-date thing, the most acceptable way, and the what do I say, a wry sense of humor he had. And on the sense of humor, there was perfect agreement between him and me. the sense of humor, bordering on the wicked. I should say, his sense of humor bordered on the wicked. So, this combination of a sense of humor, a brilliant language, a very, very attractive style of presentation, the up-to-date knowledge of the subject, the erudition, this made him perhaps one of the best teachers that I have come across. Now, I have listened to many of his lectures. Occasionally, I used to tell him, so what are you teaching today? He would say, no, I'm going to teach enlightenment, the philosophy of enlightenment. And he said, I'm sitting in a corner of the classroom. You know, in the first instance, he would say, badamara, embarrassing altre. Then I would insist, no, I will sit in a corner in a very, very innocuous manner without disturbing you. Then this was a usual practice. He would sit in the class where I was lecturing on feudalism and other things. Oh. I would sit in his class. Oh yes, in MA class, most of the time, many of his lectures I have audited. Many of my lectures he has audited. Then we organized refresher courses for college teachers. And there wasn't a single lecture of mine that he did not listen to. And there wasn't a single lecture of his that I did not listen to. And there was this problem. Some of the guests whom we had invited wouldn't be able to come. And we would know about it only that day. We will not be able to make alternative arrangements. Then Surendra would ask me, Keshava, yottu bere upaya illa ilayada kalavidare maadbekagutte. And that is the way in which he uses yottu bere upaya illa ilayada kalavidare maadbekagutte aitu neevu hottira nanu agbeka aa neenu go. So without any notice, without meenogu, alladre nane hogtene. So like that. And so the UGC stipulates that one person shouldn't give more than 5 lectures. But we have given more than 10 lectures in each of the courses that we have. And because this is the contingency in which we were, there wasn't anybody available, either him or me. So, the expression that he used was the Nilayada Kalavidaru. Nilayada Kalavidaru. Then, and I remember there was one lady teaching in St. Agnes College who was Surendra Rao's classmate. His classmate in Mysore. She used to attend this and she once came to the two of us, saying that I don't need this at all. You know, because I have got all my promotions, I am not required to do this. I came here just to listen to the lectures of two of you. When she said two of you, she actually meant Surendra Rao. Because she didn't want to say that I wanted to listen to my friend's lecture. So she included me also there as an excuse for her to listen to the lectures. So in this way, Surendra Rao established a tradition there in Mangalore University. Now, if you ask me, what is his contribution to history? No, he hasn't written much. He was a very shy person when it came to writing. Now, I used to tell him, no, why don't you write? Why don't you publish? Because, no, you are a good teacher, your students know it. But when you write, the world knows about you. Then he used to say, Ade madaya problem out there. When I have seen all these people writing, when there is such a rich material, they will be comparing me with that. And I don't want to cut a sorry figure. And yes, that is what he used to say. When there is so much for me to study, when there is so much for me to learn, what is my justification? He used to ask, what is my justification to add one more thing into this? No, he refused to write. Then I had to use all sorts of force, including physical, to make him write a paper to go to Indian History Congress. Indian History Congress is the forum of historians, All India Forum of Historians, where more than 2,000 historians meet every year. So I used to use force, make him write a paper, and those papers were received very well there. Then he very, very reluctantly, he was a very reluctant kind of, now I used to tease him, saying that you have a fear of the white surface. So when you have this white paper in front of you to deface it by your pen, you have a fear of the white surface, you must get rid of the, you must put across water. So he confined everything to himself. What little, no, I can say with the pride that whatever he has written, whatever he has published, at least part of it is because of my persuasion bordering on forcing. I had forced him to do it. I can say this with some justification. A second thing that we have to mention about him is as a friend. Now, I can tell you, last year, about this time, I was away from home. I was watching a Sanskrit drama when suddenly Vishu, Surendra's younger son, telephoned to me to say that, Uncle, it's all over. This is what he said. Uncle, it's all over. Now, I have experienced the death of many friends, many relatives, my parents, many relatives, many senior relatives. But I haven't cried when many people died. Only very, very few deaths made me cry. And Surendra Rao is one person who made me cry, not just by his death. Now, when in November last year, November last year, 22nd or so, no, he was taken to hospital on the 19th, I remember.
November 19th
is his birthday.
Yeah.
He was taken to hospital on 19th November. I didn't know about this. So on 22nd or so, I telephoned to him. He wouldn't answer the phone, but the phone was ringing. It kept on ringing. On the third ring, a female voice answered the phone and told me in Tulu. I cannot reproduce what she said in Tulu. No, because I'll not be able to, but I was able to understand. Annare is admitted to the hospital. This is what she told me. So I learned that it is the domestic help who used to go to his house, Shubha, who answered the phone. And I learned that he is in the hospital. I immediately telephoned to Chinnappa Gowda, his neighbor, and perhaps a very, very good friend, an extremely nice person, a very good friend of both Surendra Rao and me. I immediately telephoned to Chinnappa Gowda and learned that he was in the hospital, that he was in the ICU. But I didn't wait for a reservation in the train. My wife and I jumped into the next train, unreserved, went all the way from Thrissur to Mangalore, is about 9 hours. Went all the way to Mangalore, went to Erlagatte to that hospital. He was in the ICU. By the time Vishu was there, Chinnappa Gowda was there, Chinnappa Gowda and Vishu, we went there, he was in the hospital. And at the door of the ICU, they managed to get me the necessary dress for entering into the ICU with that mask and the hair cap and the gown. I entered there. I saw him lying there. He just opened his eyes. I don't know if he recognized me. I held his hand. I didn't want to see that Surendra Rao. I came out and cried. And it took a lot for Chinnappa Gowda and my wife to console me. Now, because now the picture of Surendra Rao that I have in my mind is not the picture of Surendra Rao whom I knew for 27 years.
Yes, sir.
That very cheerful, very ebullient kind of friend. No, that piece of vegetable lying on a bed in an ICU with a mask, oxygen mask, and just staring at me in a stuporous condition. He was staring at me. No, that is something which I did not want. That is something which I did not want to see. So, in death, in my last meeting him, I cried. He can make me cry. Now, you cry for two reasons. One is when you are sad. The other is when you feel that here is a person who is worth crying for. And for me, I think Surendra Rao has been a person who was always worth crying for. But I'm sorry, I'll not be able to continue. I'm sorry, I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Sir, thank you very much. You have made us wet. I'm very sad that I had no such close association with my own brother. But he was very affectionate to us. He was mingling with us in my family. And his penchant for music was really just flowing in my household here. He loved my child Ranjani and also three children who were groomed here, singing very beautifully well in Carnatic music. And he was quite appreciative of these children's progress. Every time he would come and he would reward them with something or the other, and his eyes would be wet when he left my house. And I never thought that I should retain his voice, at least. I don't have that. And at least now, I'm just recollecting my association with him now. That such an abode of knowledge, he has not left anything except the books. Some 17,000 books are there, lying there, eating dust. And nobody knows anything about this great, great man. And in fact, I tell you the truth. Why I have started this Facebook program. I have acquired a little knowledge about music. And I will also become like Surendra after some time. And why should I do that? I thought that I should leave some aspects of music to the posterity. In one way or the other, whatever capacity that I have, I should leave it. Whether it is a matter to the dustbin or really to be elevated, I do not know. But anyway, I have started it since July. The reason was COVID, that I had enough time to do all these things. And we did it. In fact, it is only because of Surendra Rao's that should not happen to any other who are really rich, knowledgeable persons. His father went away just like that. He was another genius I have seen in my life.
Absolutely.
Genius. And second genius, I had my uncle Bagalodi Devarao, another genius. He left a few books, of course, written by him, and without being recognized in the society in a due way, all these people left. So at least the time has made me to think that I should make, as a brother, a benevolent brother, that I should make his name to be known at least to my circle. And thus, I have invited you. You are really made for each other. You two are made for each other. I know that. I also know Dr. Chinnappa Gowda and Dr. Vivek Rai. And I have requested them also to speak about Dr. Rao during this week, that they would share their feelings about this great personality. Shall I ask you a few questions?
Oh, please. Please.
His teachings to the students, I was told that it was going overhead. The students used to admire him and adore him. Listening to his characteristic humors, wits, and even acerbic pungences. Did he really produce the students to live up to his expectations?
We have discussed this. We have discussed this. Surendra Rao said that we can take two positions. One is, avarige adella artha agodilla adella helodu beda. And now that is one position that we can take. The other is, tell them what you know, tell them what you think they should know. And if at least one of them in the 15 or 20 that you are teaching there, if one of them takes an interest and studies there, you are successful. So these are the two positions. Now if we take the former position, that avarige adella beda, if you take that position, the result is that in 1 or 2 years, you too will stop reading, you too will stop learning, because you know that avarige adella beda. Now, when you are teaching MA class, why should you read the most recent book? Why should you read the most recent research article which has come in the journal? So, avarige idella beda. Avarige idella beda, really, Surendra Rao, nanige idella beda. He really wanted to update his knowledge and he didn't want to hold it back from others. He didn't want to hold it back from others. Now, his lectures, if it went overboard, it is because, even if he had, for example, we used to say this. The example that we used to say is, if we prescribe this book, will they understand it? Then he told me, in that case, prescribe Chanda Mama to them. Chanda Mama, they will be able to read and understand. Prescribe Chanda Mama. So he said that don't compromise on that. When you are teaching postgraduate classes, teach them at the postgraduate level. If they are not up to that level, we will not be able to do anything. Now, we had experience of many students whose literacy was in question. No, I'm not joking. I'm telling you a sad reality. The sad reality. Beg your pardon?
He was telling that.
Their literacy was in question. Does it mean that in the postgraduate class, teachers should be teaching them alphabets of the English language or Kannada language. Now they don't know alphabets, so we should teach them. Is that what a PG teacher is expected to do? You are expected to do certain things. You have a mandate. You fulfill that. Then there is always this feeling. Now this is a dilemma that Indian tradition has had. In making a gift, you should give it to the right person. Satpatra dalli dana madbeku. So you have this. No, is it satpatra or apapatra that you are giving the gift to? You don't have to worry about this. University tells him that he is good enough to sit in the MA class because you have given him admission according to the rules of the university. So the university believes that that person, he or she, is fit enough to sit in the MA class, which means that you have to assume that he or she is sitting in the MA class and address him as an MA student. Now, I am with Surendra Rao, and that is why towards the end of our career, we became hugely unpopular as teachers. Hugely unpopular because, ഒള്ളേ ലെക്ചർമാരായ ഏനും അർത്ഥാകുന്നില്ല. That was the kind of compliment that we used to get. ഒള്ളേ ലെക്ചർമാരായ ഏനും അർത്ഥാകുന്നില്ല. If that is the kind of compliment that you get to a lecture that you are giving, then you can understand, and you can also realize that it is time for you to quit. Now, you said when you began talking all sorts of things about me, you said that I decided to take retirement when he was retiring. Yes, I knew that Mangalore University campus, history department of Mangalore University campus, will not be the place for me without Surendra Rao. I knew it. And one of our friends, perhaps you know him, Professor Karanth of ISAC Bangalore. Professor Karanth made this observation to Surendra. Surendra, what a wonderful felicitation have you got. Now, at the time of retirement, felicitation volumes are given, felicitation speeches are given, but nobody else has got this kind of a felicitation, saying that I will not stay in the place where you are not there anymore. So 2 years before my due, I decided to leave the university because I realized that is the wrong place for me without him. No, I didn't want to stay in that department without him.
I cannot express a single word for this.
No, the reason is very simple. The reason is very simple. It is not just about friendship. It is the atmosphere that he created there. It is the atmosphere that, there I think I can use the word we. We created a particular atmosphere in that department. And without that atmosphere, neither of us would be able to. No, in fact, I had written to the university asking the university to relieve me in the month of July. And I had a certain commitment to the French Institute of Pondicherry, which was over only in the month of April. So I wanted to leave the university because it had become absolutely impossible to stay there. So I said I am leaving. I wrote this letter, and that was one letter which I wrote without telling him that I am asking for voluntary retirement. I did not tell him.
Oh.
After I sent this letter, I told him, he said, so when have you asked to leave you? I said, July. ಹಾಗಿದ್ರೆ ನವೆಂಬರ್ ತನಕ ನಿಂತು ಬಿಡು ಹಿ ಸರ್ ನವೆಂಬರ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ರಿಟೈರ್ ಆಗ್ತೇನೆ ನವೆಂಬರ್ ತನಕ ನಿಂತು ಬಿಡು ನೀನು ನಿನ್ನೆ ಲೆಟರ್ ಅಮೆಂಡ್ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಲೆಟರ್ ಬರೆ ಇಮ್ಮಿಡಿಯೇಟ್ಲಿ ಐ ರೋಟ್ ದಟ್ ಲೆಟರ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಇನ್ ಪಾರ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಮಾಡಿಫಿಕೇಶನ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೈ ಲೆಟರ್ ಡೇಟೆಡ್ ಸಚ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸಚ್ ಐ ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಯು ಟು ರಿಲೀವ್ ಮೀ ವಿತ್ ಇಫೆಕ್ಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ 30th November instead of 31st July 2008.
My God.
No, because he didn't want to, what I say is, he didn't want to stay there for the remaining months. From July to November, he didn't want to stay there without me. I didn't want to stay there at all. Now the reason is the atmosphere and also the friendship. I used to address him Rao Mama. Perhaps you know that.
Yeah.
I used to address him Rao Mama. The reason is very simple. He was a member of my own household. My children used to call him Rao Mama. And when my children used to call him Rao Mama, my wife also used to address him Rao Mama. And I too. Not only that, in the whole of Kerala, he has more friends in Kerala than in Karnataka. This is because of me. In the whole of Kerala, Surendra Rao is known only as Rao Mama. And later when I joined Delhi, he used to come to Delhi University and ICHR. And all over Delhi, he is known as Rao Mama.
So nice.
Rao Mama was a household name. In my house, he was a member of my, on many days, I would, we would be talking about various things, history, the way in which the next revision of syllabus should be done, etc. Then suddenly when we look at the watch, it would be already 1:30. Oh, it's already 1:30. That is why I am feeling hungry. So I would immediately pick up the phone and ask my wife, do you have enough rice for the two of us? She said, yes, we can adjust. So we would go there, and he didn't stand on any ceremonies. Now perhaps my wife may have made some tambuli, just that. But absolutely no problem. What little fare and he would eat, he would be eating there in my house. And then, you know, the way in which, my wife was terribly ill. Now I can never forget this. My wife was terribly ill. She had this was a premenopausal problem of heavy bleeding and loss of blood and the very low level of hemoglobin, etc. And I had a very important meeting in Kottayam which I couldn't miss. So I asked Surendra Rao, this is the condition. Okay. In our manager. So my wife went and stayed with them. Your Chikamma looked after her as own daughter. For 1 week, she was under the care of your Chikamma.
Oh.
And this is the way in which we were related. Now he came home, that is my village in Kerala. He came home for the first time to attend my wedding. This was in 1983. Since then, the number of times that he has visited, his son has visited, I will not be able to count. Similarly, the number of times I have visited them in Puttur, and I haven't visited them in Asaiguli because I was most of the time there. No, you don't visit your house, do you? So I haven't visited that house. I was in that house. Then one word. It is good that you reminded me about the one word about his father. You were saying that he is one person who has impressed me most. Now one day when I went to Puttur, he was sitting there, in that veranda where he had that closed room. He was looking at something very closely and brightly. Then when he said, please come. You see, I was comparing these two dictionaries.
My goodness.
The way in which a particular word, the meaning of that word is given in this dictionary and the same word defined in another dictionary. You see, this Oxford Shorter Dictionary definition is always better than Webster's dictionary. So he was comparing dictionaries and telling me that between Oxford Dictionary and Webster's Dictionary, Oxford dictionary is better than Webster's dictionary in many matters. But he also told me, when it is an American expression that you have, Webster's is better than Oxford.
Wow.
So he would compare every word, and he has given me, now he had, you know, he had several dozens of dictionaries. One of them he has gifted me.
Oh.
And the marginal notes in the dictionary.
Kittal, huh?
You write marginal notes in dictionaries. Now, I have this bad habit of writing marginal notes in the books that I read. But in a dictionary, I don't make marginal notes. So this is one thing. Another was, on another occasion when I went there, on a piece of paper, he was drawing some map. So I thought, that, you know, since he was a lawyer, he was going to court. I thought he was preparing the plan of a field where there was some contestation. And then I didn't pursue it. But when we started talking, I asked him, by the way, uncle, is it some field about which you are making a presentation in the court? That, no, he was telling me that was a village in Somalia. The map of which... Incredible. Surendra Rao has told me an experience. One of Surendra Rao's uncles, the one who was in Deccan Herald, he had occasion to visit London. And when he came back, and he was talking to his elder brother, Sripati Rao. And in one of the conversations, he asked him, which hotel did you stay? Such and such a hotel. Where exactly is this? Such and such a street. So he said, from Piccadilly Square, you get turn to the left and take this street and you go there and reach that hotel, isn't it? He said, but Anna, have you visited London? But I know my map. this was what his father was. His command over the English language. No, Surendra Rao's command over the English language is something which he inherited from his father, minus the nuances of grammar. The nuances of grammar, Surendra Rao's father was very good at. Now, I don't know if you remember, about 20-25 years back in the Hindu, there used to be this column, Know Your English, which a certain Subramanyam was doing. And in that, every Tuesday, this column was every Tuesday. In 1 week, he had reproduced the first year question paper of Madras University in 1958. General English, grammar and general English, the question paper he had reproduced. So that weekend I had gone there and he was very enthusiastic. He asked me, did you read Know Your English this week? I said, yes. Did you see the question paper? Yeah. Did you try to answer it? I said, yes. How much marks do you get?
Wow.
I said, I get 37. 37 out of 100. I said, yes. He said, I get 50. he said, I get 50. So this is an FA question paper, I remember. An FA question paper on grammar and general English. And look at the enthusiasm. And as you very rightly said, he was wasting there in that small town of Puttur. He had nobody to talk to. He had this interest in music. He would go to Madras for the music festival. He would stay in Madras for days on end, listen to this program, come back. He had his interest in music. He had that old transistor radio. You remember that? He had that transistor radio. Yeah. He would listen to all stations where Carnatic music was there. And your cousin, Surendra Rao, inherited these two from his father. Although he was not very happy to accept that these are inheritances from his father. And he has also told me about the wonderful days that he had in your household when he was a child. with Professor Hebbar, Ekutendra Hebbar, Doddanna. From him, the way in which he loved the lived there, he loved his Doddamma and Doddappa, and the way in which he was looked after. He used to say that he was much happier in that household than in his own.
True.
He used to tell about that. So that is what I closed with. That is, Surendra Rao, apart from Surendra Rao, the scholar and the teacher, there was another dimension of Surendra Rao. Surendra Rao, the friend, Surendra Rao, the human being. That is what we are missing. And I cannot think that it is already 1 year since he left us, because he hasn't left us. He is with us even now, and he will remain. We will not be able to miss him. Thank you very much.
Rightly said, sir. Thank you very much. Surendra Raya-rige befitting one tribute andre nimma mate sari. Idu really, I have become speechless. Surendra, when he used to come, when he came here, Keshavan Higalda. And every time your name will come here. And when you volunteered to go for retirement, it has come to my house. We have discussed also. And after you left to Delhi, he opted to come to my house and stay for 2 days. I am alone now. I know ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೇಸರ ಆಗಿದೆ ಆ ಟೈಮ್ನಲ್ಲಿದ್ದ. ಐ ನೋ ದಟ್ ನಿಮ್ಮಿಬ್ಬರ ಒಳಗಿನ ಸಂಬಂಧ ನಾನು ಫ್ರಮ್ ಎ ಡಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸೀನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ಲವ್ಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ರೆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಯು ಅಂಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಆಲ್ ಲವ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಫೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಐ ಬೋ ಡೌನ್ ಟು ಯು ಫಾರ್ ಯುವರ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಅಫೆಕ್ಷನ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಚೇಂಜ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಸ್. Thank you on behalf of my trust. I should really thank you very much.
Thank you.
That you have really enlightened us. Another aspect of Dr. Surendra Rao with my viewers and my family members. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.